N factorial. It stands for N times the number that would come before it, N minus 1, times the number before that, N minus 2, and so on, all the way down the line to 3 times 2 times 1. N factorial multiplies all of these numbers together. So for example, 6 factorial would be 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, or 720. So you can see that factorials get large pretty quickly. But what if n is very large? Then what? Let's say, what if n were 10 to the 100th power, or a Google? A Google is just one with 100 zeros at the end of it. So what would a Google factorial be equal to? That surely must be an astronomical number. We're going to need a very powerful estimation tool to be able to approximate this number. That's where Stirling's formula comes in. So we begin by defining n factorial using something called the gamma function. And the gamma function is defined by this indefinite integral from 0 to infinity of t to the nth power e to the negative t dt. And we're going to do a bunch of different substitutions here, starting with t to the nth power. We're going to change this to e to the n natural log of t. This is going to allow us to combine the integrands of this integral into a single exponential whose exponent is n natural log of t minus t. We're going to do a second substitution here by letting t equal n times n, and therefore dt would be n dy. So inputting this into that exponential right there and exploring what happens to the natural log, we can exploit some of the rules of natural logarithms and use that to try to pull a constant out of this integral. So now rewriting the integrand and separating some of the exponentials with the constant parts, and noticing the n is also a constant, we can now factor those constants out of the integral and make our integrand a little easier to work with. So now our integrand is e raised to the n times natural log of y minus y, and then dy. Now here's where our estimation or approximation is going to come into play. We're going to explore the function, the natural log of x minus x, which is the exponential part of this integrand. And we notice that if we looked at it as a function, it would have a maximum value at x equals 1, and then decrease or drop off going away from x equals 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to use something called a Taylor series approximation to this function. Now, a Taylor series expansion about the point x equals 1 is what we're going for here. Now, I'm not going to define a Taylor series expansion here in this video, but you can check and verify that f of x is equal to natural log of x minus x is the series that I'm putting down here. Negative 1 minus x minus 1 squared over 2 plus x minus 1 over cubed over 3, etc. It's an alternating series. And if we just take the first two terms of that series for our approximation, we'll have a pretty good approximation to what the actual integrand would be. So doing a little replacement here, we now have an integrand whose exponent there is negative 1 minus y minus 1 squared over 2. And again, just like before, we can pull out a constant part of that integrand and simplify our integrand just a little bit further. So we can pull an e to the negative n power out of this integrand and then re-examine what the integral is trying to ask us to find. So the integral then we have to deal with is from 0 to infinity, e to the negative n over 2 times y minus 1 squared. Now we're getting very close to making our integral look like something called a Gaussian integral. And I'm going to clean up the constants in front there just a little bit. Now this Gaussian style integral is a bell curve, a normal bell curve. So what we could do is try first to do a little substitution to clean it up. Let w equal y minus 1 and dw would equal dy, but this is going to change the limits of integration on our particular integral here, starting it from negative 1 to infinity. Now as it stands, we might have a little trouble analyzing what happens by switching these limits of integration, but if we analyze and look at the two integrals together as a graph, we'll notice something curious. Both integrals have exactly the same area under the curve because as n goes to infinity, the area under the curve goes to zero on either side of that bell curve. So these two graphs have identical areas. So that's good. We can use that to our advantage in our approximation. So we can assume that this integral right here is basically from 0 to infinity of e to the negative n over 2 x squared dx. Now this is a famous Gaussian integral, and there are many videos showing you how to calculate this. I'm going to calculate it using a trick due to Richard Feynman. So we're going to let alpha be n over 2. And we're going to define a function of t as the integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to the negative alpha t squared times x squared plus 1 all over x squared plus 1 dx. And we make a couple of observations that if we evaluate this function of t at 0, we get an arctangent integral which is going to evaluate to pi over 2. And then if we took this integral out to infinity, we would get 0. So by the fundamental theorem of calculus, we could write f of t, the integral of f prime of t, as f of infinity minus f of 0, which would give us negative pi over 2. So we'll use this in a little bit. All right, so we've evaluated what that is equal to, and now we're going to consider what it means to take the derivative of f prime of t. So differentiating with respect to time, or t, okay, everything with respect to x or alpha in that integral is going to be treated like a constant, and when you differentiate an integral, you can bring that in as a partial derivative inside the integrand when you differentiate. Now, the beautiful thing here is when we do, in fact, differentiate that integrand with respect to time, or t, we get a bunch of constants, as it were, to pull out of this, and a few cancellations to work in our favor. So the x squared plus 1s cancel here. And we can pull the negative 2at constant out of the integral and start to boil this integral down to something that looks like a Gaussian integral like we saw before. And with a little bit of, again, simplification of that exponential part of the function e, we can pull out some more constants from this integrand, getting negative 2 alpha t e to the negative alpha t squared, and then just having the integral from 0 to infinity e to the negative alpha tx quantity squared dx. Another substitution will allow us to simplify this integral once again. We'll get a factor of 1 over t to come out of this new substituted integral and cancel with the t in front there. And so we'll have negative 2 alpha e to the negative alpha t squared of the integral from 0 to infinity of e to the negative alpha z squared dz. This is where the fun part comes in. So now integrating this from 0 to infinity is integrating the derivative. And so we're going to integrate this from 0 to infinity, but we already have an integral in the integrand from 0 to infinity that is going to be an exact copy of the one we're doing. So now, negative 2 alpha integral from 0 to infinity e to the negative alpha t squared dt multiplied by another integral of 0 to infinity e to the negative alpha t squared dt gives us an integral squared, and we know that the other side of this is going to be equal to negative pi over 2. So now, simplifying some things, isolating that squared integral, and then taking the square root of both sides gives us an evaluation of the Gaussian integral, which evaluates to square root of pi over alpha. And since alpha was n over 2, we get the square root of 2 pi over n. and this is going to help complete our formula for Stirling's approximation. So now this integral being square root of 2 pi over n, and playing around with the powers of n here, we can clean this up and write n factorial is going to be approximately equal to n over e raised to the nth power times the square root of 2 pi n. This is Stirling's formula, and it approximates n factorial much better as we let n get very large, so it will do the trick for us. We want to use this to approximate a Google factorial. So we're going to let n equal 10 to the 100th power, which is a Google. Now, 10 to the 100th power factorial substituted into the formula is approximately equal to a Google divided by e raised to a Google multiplied by the square root of 2 pi times a Google. Now, a Google divided by e is really going to be irrelevant, so that's essentially the same thing as just a Google. So we have a Google raised to a Google. And underneath the square root, we have 2 pi, and we can evaluate that 10 to the 100th power under the square root by making it 10 to the 50th power. Now we can make 100 as 10 squared and use a lot of the powers of exponents to combine all of those powers of 10 and pull out that constant of a square root of 2 pi. We can approximate further by noticing that that first term is 10 to the 10 to the 102th power plus 50, but that plus 50 part is really not going to make a difference. It's going to be negligible. And so we could basically say that this part right here is 10 to the 10 to the 100th power as a good estimation, multiplied by the square root of 2 pi. Square root of 2 pi compared to 10 to the 10 to the 100th power is very small, and so we can neglect that term. And so 10 to the 100th power factorial is approximately equal to 10 to the 10 to the 100th power, which is also known as a Googleplex. A Google factorial is equal to a Googleplex, approximately. Hey, I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell for more videos.